And as the New South Wales government makes plans to legislate protections for Aboriginal languages, some are concerned it will do the opposite and give the state too much control over them. Rachael Hocking spent some time with one of those concerned communities and learned how they are keeping their language and culture alive.
Yam Naya Clark Webb, Yam Naya Gumbaynggirr Nigger, Kala Banjlang Wau, Wala Yeagir. I'm Clark Webb, I'm a Gumbaynggirr man. I speak a little bit of Gumbaynggirr, but I'm also a Banjlang and also Yeagir, I think. Gulana, 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 Gulana.
Once a week, Clark Webb visits elder Uncle Beng. Using his phone, he records their conversations, spoken in Gumbaynggirr.
What's that mean?
It's the first time Clark has heard this phrase. It's a major discovery and invaluable because no book or linguist would know of it. Uncle Beng is believed to be the last person alive who grew up speaking Gumbaynggirr as a first language. To Clark, he is a walking university.
At about the age of 14, when I heard an old man by the name of Uncle Beng from Corindi and his brother Uncle Bruce speak, conversing to each other in language and in Gumbaynggirr, and I remember just going, oh wow, I want to be able to speak like that, my language.
Clark is on a mission. He's part of a dedicated nation bringing language back to their mob, but not in a conventional way. This morning, Clark's up early to take a community class. He's using a method known as ASLA, or Accelerated Second Language Acquisition, a method designed by Arapaho man, Dr. Gray Morning, from the University of Montana.
So it's all what you can see, and so you see it, and then the first step is to respond to those sounds, and then the next step is to then speak those sounds. So. Which is the way you learn your first language. We know that our languages were never traditionally written, and so it's just there, you know, the language is in our landscape.
Despite strides made, Clark is concerned his people will lose control of the way language is handed down. In particular, he's deeply concerned at the allocation of funding from the state government. While the New South Wales government has committed $4.4 million from 2014 to language revitalisation programs, some grassroots language groups say they should be involved in deciding where that money goes. It's evening just south of Coffs in Nambucca Heads, and Mudabai Cultural Centre is holding a Certificate 3 class in Gumbaynggirr. It's a common standard accepted by the Department of Education and one many community members have been eager to attain. But while Clark supports any effort to revitalise Gumbaynggirr, he doesn't think he needs this certificate to prove it.
We're being told how our language needs to be taught and learnt. We're being told who can and can't teach our language. You know, to teach language, I wouldn't be too worried about people's spelling of the language, for example. We should be making decisions of who the most appropriate people are to teach our language. We should be training up our teachers to do it, not anyone else for us.
The question is, will the state government listen and take notice of what's being said? Today, people living in and around Coffs Harbour are coming together to talk about how to solidify community control of language into legislation.
It's about coming to community, consulting on what the current draft bill is, and gauging their feedback for future input into the newly revised bill, which will go back to Cabinet in September this year.
The New South Wales government's plan to protect the state's Aboriginal languages was announced last year. And for the past few months, it's been holding community consultations to understand how they want their languages to be enshrined in law.
You know, if it doesn't work, they throw more money at it. If it does work, they kill it. Over and over again.
What's the guarantee that Aboriginal community ownership's going to be upheld?
You know, it needs to be in community, and schools should be allowing access for our
kids to be able to attend at, in community, on community, not necessarily in a school setting.
I think, you know, and what Ruben said before, we've got a lot of community members that, you know, from different communities that have actually expressed the same thing.
There's been some remarkable work done by a lot of people across the state, New South Wales. We're very lucky. I believe that there's been some strides, but I believe that we have to have more of a say now.
Really, we couldn't not be heard today because we're all on the same page. We're all talking about the same thing. All of our community is talking about the need for our Aboriginal communities to own our language, to be driving our language, and for us to be empowered in our language.
This community has had its say, and the state government now has a few months to draft legislation that meets their expectations. For now, Clark is focusing on what he can change. Ensuring the next generation continues his work and that of the men and women before him.
I'm really hoping in 5 years we've got 50 fluent speakers happening, and in 10 years that we've got first speakers coming through. For each generation to be a stronger speaker than the last. Everything that we are. Kid, it was like something that was missing, you know, and it's filled that hole for me.
Good. Okay, good. Give me a bird.